rejoice, give thanks, and sing. Everybody singing with me, praising God. Here we go. Rejoice if you're in heart. Rejoice, give thanks, and sing. Your festal banner wave on high. Cross of Christ the King. Rejoice, 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 give thanks, and sing. With voice as full and strong as ocean surging praise, for the sturdy hymns of old, the psalms of ancient days. Rejoice, 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 give thanks, and sing. With all the angels' choir, with all the saints of earth, pour out the strains of joy and bliss to rapture noblest birth. Rejoice, 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 give thanks, and sing. Yes, on through life's long path, still chanting as ye go, from youth to age, by night and day, in gladness and in woe. Rejoice, 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 give thanks, and sing. Praise him who reigns on high. Praise him who reigns on high. The Lord whom we adore. The Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. One God forevermore. Rejoice, 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 give thanks, and sing. Amen. Please be seated.
We have a pleasant surprise, and that I just heard, I believe it was yesterday or the day before, that Danny Shelton, director of 3ABN, is coming through Miami, and he has brought a friend with him, and so we want to give him and his friend an opportunity this morning to share with us. I know that all of us have heard of 3ABN, and so we are so delighted to have Danny Shelton with us today.
Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning.
And I have with me Dr. Yvonne Lewis. How many of you watch Dare to Dream? Have you heard of Dare to Dream Network? Okay, we got a work to do, and we got just a couple minutes to do it. First of all, thank you all for your love and your prayers and financial support of 3ABN as we endeavor to take this great gospel of the kingdom into all the world. And I don't have to ask how many of you watch, because as we came in through the hallways, and many of you that we say, we watch 3ABN all the time. But we have a new network. It's called Dare to Dream. Dr. Yvonne Lewis is our Dare to Dream manager. And we want to take just a moment and tell you not only about it, but how you can watch it here in the Miami area.
Good morning.
Good morning.
What a blessing it is to worship with you here this morning. Dare to Dream is such a blessing because it actually targets, it's an urban network, and it targets inner city residents. But what we're finding is that it transcends culture. People of every culture are watching it, and they're saying, we are really being blessed by the programming. We have programming on money management, on a program for ex-offenders, because we find that a lot of people are trying to leave a prison and re-enter society, and what do? We let them know that God is there for them. We have programs on health and relationships and all kinds of different programs to meet the needs of inner city residents. So we ask you to check us out. Tune in. Now let me tell you how. First of all, you can go to the website, 3abn.org, or you can go to the Dare to Dream website, which is d2dnetwork.tv. How many of you have a cell phone? Well, we have a free app. 3ABN has a free app on the cell phone, and you can download it from your app store, and when you do, you will get all of the networks that 3ABN has 24/7. You can watch 3ABN, you can watch Dare to Dream, you can watch 3ABN Latino. All of the networks are represented, so, and it's free. Download it. The other thing is, we ask you to go to your texting, and you can text $10 to Dare to Dream. And all you have to do with that is, in the text box, you text 52,000 in the text box, and in the message, you just write Dream, and then hit Send. And then they'll ask you, are you sure you want to do this? And you hit yes, and it's $10 going to Dare to Dream. We can use our cell phones as an evangelistic tool to take the gospel to the world. Thank you.
How many of you appreciated that time of worship? Amen. Every evening we're going to have also a time of worship. I believe that some of the most important things in the Christian life are to sing praises to God. Amen. And thank you for the team that has led us in worship, and each evening we'll also do so. What if we just stopped going through the motions and gave it all to God? What if for once we were just to say, Lord, I'm tired and I want to start living the life you promised? Jesus has invited us to receive that new life. Amen. And today I want to talk to you about that life. But before I do, and if we can have the presentation, and then that way, just a few weeks ago, we were visiting with a, I would say, young lady, 51 years old. At my age, that's a young person. And she was slumped over the table we were meeting. We were meeting around a table, and she was just slumped over. And she said, I was raised an Adventist. For those who are visitors here, that would be one of the people that's around you. And went to Oakwood College. Went to Walla Walla, received a degree or several degrees. And then drifted away. Drifted away because it seems like many times there's so much talk about the Christian life, yet very little reality. We seem to be subject to the same things day after day. I found myself doing that this week. I don't know what it is about Miami. Pastor Lou said if somebody had already screamed at me while you're driving. And I said, no, I was screaming at them. I wanted to get the upper hand, but I was thinking, what am I doing? What am I doing? So she had gone through the motions and felt that there was nothing there and just wandered away to see if there was something better. And in that wandering, made a real mess of her life. Made such a mess of her life that started drinking and smoking and using substances. The point in her life a few months earlier than we were visiting her, she liked a fellow, gave him money and started, you know, a friendship which she believed could be more. And he left. He left where they were living. And she followed him because she thought there was something there. And when she got to where he was, He trashed her, made her feel worse than junk, and took the little self-esteem that she had and tore it apart. And that got her into a spin where she almost lost her life. And there we were sitting around a table, and she said, I want to come back to God, but I don't have anything. Anything. I have God let me down. That's the way she put it. How can I even believe in God? And I want to quit smoking, but I don't have the strength to be able to do it. And so I asked her a few questions because we had helped people in the past to quit smoking. But one of the things that we found the hardest was a person who is on medications, legal medications, antidepressants. It's very difficult for them to quit smoking. And I won't get into the dynamics. What would God have for her? You're going to hear the rest of the story in the evenings. Is that all right? It's a wonderful story you need to hear. Because God is real.
Amen.
Because he can make a difference in our lives, and he invites us. He invites us to to experience life at its fullest. Jesus said, I have come so that they may have life and have it in what? Isn't that neat? A full life, an abundant life. And by the way, many are waiting for that abundant life to take place when Jesus comes. But you know what Jesus was talking about? That here in the now, in our lives, in your life, in my life. And so this morning, let's just talk for a moment that Jesus is inviting us to experience life at its fullest. Another young man asked me, what do I do, Ed? I have an alternate sexual lifestyle. I won't get into the particulars. It's in my jeans, and he's not talking about his pants. And I've prayed, and God has not delivered me. Will the church accept me? What a wonderful question. Do you want to know the rest of that story? You know the answer. So Paul, taking from what Jesus had offered, that full life, he encourages us to be filled with the glorious riches of the hope of glory, to be filled with Christ. And that's what it's all about, to be filled with Christ. You see, Paul was talking about an experience in which people would not gauge their relationship with Christ with the exteriors. And we're good at that. We're good at asking God to bless us in certain things, to bless us in our courtships, in our families, with our children, with our loved ones, with our finances. And we want to live decorated lives. Do you follow me? As if we were pottery, and we believe that our relationship is good with Jesus as long as we can make the outside beautiful. Are you with me? As long as we can drive up to the church in a nice car, as long as we can drive up to the church with a person beside us and have company, and we have attained. But you know what Paul says? That more importantly than what is happening in the exterior of our lives is what is happening inside our lives that makes the real difference. Be filled with the riches of Jesus Christ, he says. You see, because when we are filled with the riches, then when the circumstances of life hit us, if we don't have them, we're like a sinkhole. We're empty. All our exterior crumbles, and nothing is left. Are you with me? But those that are filled with Christ, even in the most difficult circumstances, in Trinidad, I met a lady that week, someone had gone into a hospital room and murdered her niece. just walked into a hospital room and murdered her niece. And yet when I saw that lady, there was a peace about her that I could not understand. That in the worst of circumstances, she had a fortitude inside, a presence of Christ in such a way that she could go through the most difficult circumstances with a sense of peace, fullness of life. That's what it's about. So what does it mean to have that fullness of life in Christ? Well, it means several things. Number one, is it is going like from death to life. And a lot of these things I will not explain because I'm going to talk about this. This is what it'll be this week. It'll be about experiencing a life worth living. Finally, a life worth living. And by the way, if you are a Christian for many years, come. Because even if you're experiencing it, it'll help you to explain to others what you're going through. To invite others to come into that presence. And if you're one of those that, like many of us, are going through the motions, you need to come. You need to come because in this week, I can tell you that something wonderful will happen in your life. Amen. You see, it's not only just cosmetic what God wants to do in our lives. It is profound. Let's look at Ephesians. Follow me in Ephesians just for a moment. Ephesians chapter 2 describes the condition of people. It says, as for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins in which you used to live when you followed the ways of the world, the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit that is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our sinful nature. I believe that we get it wrong sometimes because as soon as we hear something, we start thinking about what we would like to do to better our lives. And I want to tell you a secret. It's not about what you can do to better your life. It's about removing the obstacles so that Christ can better your life. There's a big difference there. And I believe that we don't know all the obstacles that are ruining the relationship that we have with Jesus Christ. Because the Bible says that many times we don't know because we're living a dead existence. I believe that many Christians are living only an inch below the water. An inch below the water. If they could just prop themselves up, they would breathe life. And yet only an inch below the water, we're drowning. It reminds me for a moment of that fellow who was concerned about the imports coming in. And so his car had a high mileage. And he went to a friend and said, you know, I'm a little worried because, you know, with the new imports, with the new cars, my car that is older and has high mileage, it has no value and even to trade it in. And a friend suggested something. He said, go to a friend of mine, a mechanic, and just tell him I sent you. Just do that. And he'll get you fixed up. You know what I'm talking about, right? He'll work on that odometer. That's right. Some of you are going, yes, exactly. And so a few months later, they found each other, and he said, so how did it go? Oh, that guy was wonderful, that mechanic friend of yours. When I went, he gave me a little coffee, he sat me down and, you know, in his office. We talked for a while, and they took the car in. And then when it came out, oh, he said, so with how many miles did he leave it? He said, 190 miles. 190 miles. He said, so did you sell it? No, he says, now that it's new, I'll keep it. You see, there it is. It doesn't matter that it has 190 miles. It's still the same old car. Are you with me or not? And sometimes we think that if in the Christian life we can do one or two little cosmetic changes. I talk with people all the time and I ask them, what do you think you could do to experience Christ's presence, and they talk to me about little things that they can do, cosmetic changes. But some of the most important things that could happen in our lives, we seem to be oblivious to those things. Secondly, it means to be known and chosen by God through Jesus Christ. What a wonderful thing. Ephesians chapter 1, and we're going to be doing a lot of studying through Ephesians, so please read with me. Praise be to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with what? With every spiritual blessing. For he chose us. He chose you and I. Before the creation of the world. How about that? That means that God took the initiative even before you existed. So if you think for one moment that you need to do something to make yourself right with God, he already did it. Amen. If you think you need to take a walk to find God, he already took the walk and he's beside you. For even before the creation of the world, he chose you and I. You know, a fellow once said, well, if God knew all things and he chose us before the creation of the world, then why did he permit sin? And I believe that's a good question, isn't it? Well, I believe that Jesus, as he was creating, fashioning Adam out of the dust of the ground, for one moment as he fashioned his hands, he stood still because he knew, he foreknew, there'd be those hands that would take his hands and put them to the cross. That as he fashioned Adam's lips, that he knew that those would be the lips that would curse him and would spit on him. And Jesus, for a moment, could have said, enough. I don't need to blow the breath of life into this being. But do you know what that would have meant? That you and I would have never existed. And God, in his foreknowledge, could not spend eternity without you. He could not spend eternity without me. Because we, at that time, even before we existed, we were sons and daughters of God. And so no matter what, Jesus blew into Adam the breath of life. Today, he's willing to breathe the same life into you and I. And so what does it mean? It means to going from death to life. It means that we are known by God, sons and daughters of God. It means that we are adopted as his sons and daughters. And I won't read all these texts, but we go from bondage to freedom. The Apostle Paul constantly refers to in the New Testament that we no longer need to be bound to sin. And you're saying, but Ed, those are the realities that we struggle daily. You need to come this week, in all honesty, because we're going to be looking at what the Bible says about being freed from sin, that we no longer should serve it. And then finally, it means to have been redeemed and forgiven. To have been redeemed and forgiven. Now we can experience the life fully in Christ. Now, understand just this part right here. To have been redeemed and forgiven. Folks, the number one thing that I believe that the devil puts in our minds is that somehow we have to deserve to be redeemed and forgiven. That there's something that we need to do to be able to receive that, and that somehow everything that we do mitigates against it. But do you know what Jesus says? That part of living the new life is living with the certainty of the joy of salvation. Amen. And you can live that way. You can get up in the morning and you don't have to feel bad about yourself or sorry about yourself, but you can say, Lord, thank you. Thank you for giving me life. Thank you today because I am accepted in the Son. And you can live a joyful life. Yeah, but. Well, let me give you a few things. Also, it means, excuse me, this is the same slide. So how do we experience Christ in us? I'll give you a few things today, just in case you don't come this week, but that's all right. Number one, renewing our minds to connect with God. Renewing our minds to connect with God. God strengthens the avenues of the mind as we spend time with him. And this is something we've all known for the longest time. As long as we spend time with God, we are renewed. Is that right? As a matter of fact, I want to read this verse, 1 Corinthians, and I can read it there. We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against us, and the knowledge of God, and we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. It seems like we have to do something there, right? Seems like this is a real challenge. And you know, I believe that many people here are saying, you know, yeah, I'd like to stop going through the motions, and I'd like to yield my life to Christ, but then I'll have a fuddy-duddy life. Praying all the time, bored all the time. Actually, you'll have an extraordinary life.
Amen.
A life of joy and peace.
Amen.
And an exciting life. And it's not a life that is laborious. But guess what? It starts right there. In the renewing of our mind. The rewiring. Let me explain this for a moment. Here's a little graph here about a neuron. How about that? And those that go to school know that a neuron has a nucleus and an axon, and then the sheath, and the dendrites, and it's at the end, by the way, of the sheath. Those little points that the nucleus communicates with other neurons. So at the end of that, if this were the neuron and this is the nucleus, at the end it communicates with other neurons. As a matter of fact, some scientists, a young man had an accident and with a motorcycle, and his brain started swelling, and they had to open his skull in order for his brain to not kill him, as it was swelling, just to swell out, and then they would cover it again. But you know, when scientists have an exposed brain, they've got to do something. So they hooked him up to some instruments so delicate that they could actually tell which neuron in his brain fired. How about that? And so they would expose him to stimuli, pictures and things. They would talk to him and try to see which neuron fired, and they found the Jennifer Aniston neuron. No, this is no joke. This is scientific. And the reason they found out it was a Jennifer Aniston neuron, that when they showed that young man a picture of Jennifer Aniston, a neuron fired. Boom, fired. In other words, it started communicating with the other neurons. Then they talked about other things, and then they showed him the same picture of Jennifer Aniston. Guess what? The same neuron fired and was communicating with the others. A neuron dedicated to Jennifer Aniston. How about that? Well, the interesting thing is not that. It's that some of these neurons die. Well, hopefully the one... Jennifer Aniston, but they die, and so people say that you lose neurons. Actually, you can rewire your brain. It's not about rewiring or making new neurons. It's actually making new connections. And so if you take that axiom and you stimulate that neuron, and it has to communicate constantly, do you know what happens? That axon swells and splits. Let me show you that previous picture. Oops, the one that we had before. I should go this way. You see that? That's a nucleus. You see it has many axioms. Did you notice that? So one nucleus can have more than one axiom, and it all depends if you stimulate it. So it splits into two axioms, and now the same nucleus is communicating more information to other, up to 3, 4, and 5. How about that?
Amazing.
Do you know what that does? Is if you stimulate a certain part of your brain, it starts swelling because all those axioms actually just occupy space. Your brain folds into itself. So you have parts of your brain that actually look like the lunar landscape. Just are smooth. Those are the least utilized parts. But other parts are very utilized, and they'll fold into themselves. Now listen to this, folks. This is what I'm trying to get at. If all we stimulate in our mind are negative thoughts, negative memories, failures, disbelief, and anger, and just turning on the news in the morning for the first thing that you do. Are you following me? Where you see people eating other people's faces off. And someone killing someone, a school teacher, a 14-year-old, just this week in Massachusetts. I can tell you that what you're doing is you're exciting certain neurons that communicate to the rest of your brain negative thoughts.
Amen.
And then you know what you say? I don't know why I don't feel at peace. Well, folks, if you eat bitter herbs, you're not going to have a sweet taste. That's about the bottom line. And so Paul says, take every thought captive. What if just this week, what if for 1 week we put the TV aside?
Amen.
Just 1 week. You can go back to it next week. Is that all right? I mean, and catch up with everything. So you can watch double next week if you want. But for 1 week, and for 1 week, instead of getting up and turning on the TV or going to the toilet and looking at the news in your iPhone, I don't know who would do that. That you got up, sat in your living room, and said, Jesus, thank you for giving me victory this week.
Amen.
And then when the neurons start firing, but you failed in the past, you know what you say? Jesus, thank you for giving me victory this week. I can sense it already happening. You know what happens? Is the neurons that have been asleep for the longest time in the lunar landscape start firing. And they start occupying space and communicating with others. And that day is a better day.
Amen.
Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom through psalms and hymns and songs of the Spirit. And that's why I believe that this week the most important would not be the subjects I'm going to hold, is that you come to church and sing together this week. How about that? Because, folks, it's even with the songs. I don't know why we bought a Jimmy Buffett CD. Yeah, I guess. I'm one of those. And we were coming down the coast from Birmingham, and we kept on playing that song, a 90-something Cadillac, 19-something Cadillac with Earl and Luana down the Tamiatic Trail. How depressing. Earl died, and now the Cadillac is being sold at some dealership. And Luana hooked up with somebody else. I didn't know that he was a country singer. But folks, you know, you have those songs and you play them over and over and over. I'm not going to get here into music and all those kinds of things, but I will let you know that every person that I've met, listen to this, all right? And this is truth. I haven't met a lot of them, but every single person I've met that is demon-possessed, young lady in close to Chattanooga who would throw Bibles during the meetings and cuss every time we said Jesus. Do you know what? She has a constant, how could I say, diet of hard rock. Def Leppard, Metallica. She loves that stuff and the skulls around her room. I wonder if it's doing something to our mind. If this week we just put that aside. Are you having negative thoughts? Are you having difficulties having a pleasant, peaceful day? Come and sing with us during the evenings. So that during the day you're singing the songs that you hear and your mind is being uplifted. I don't have much time, so I'll keep on moving. Permitting God to speak to our hearts through His Word. Let God fill you with the reassurance of His continual presence, for the Word of God is active and alive and sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to the dividing of the spirits and the joints and the marrow and judges the intentions and thoughts of the heart. Bring your Bibles during the meetings. Is that all right? Read those texts, and then in the morning, review those texts again. You see, there's the most valuable Bible. By the way, that's the most valuable Bible right there. There was a collector of Bibles, had a Bible that was 3rd century. Now understand, a 3rd century Bible is very expensive because in the 3rd century they did not have printing presses. So those were handwritten Bibles. Huge Bible in his collection. And a reporter came to his house and was talking about all those Bibles that he had, but wanted to see that 3rd century Bible. And then she asked, which to you is the Bible that you value the most? And she thought that he'd go to that Bible, and he said, no, he went to a Bible like this. a torn up Bible with a black tarry substance. And he said, that's the Bible that is the most valuable of all my collection. He says, what's so special about that Bible? He said, you see, that's a martyr's Bible. When you scratch the tarry substance, it's not tar, as if somebody was careless to leave the Bible out in the road. It's blood. The blood of a person who gave their life for Jesus. If you look at the pages, many pages are erased. There's no words on them. And you know why they're erased? Because that martyr, day after day, would rub his finger over those promises to the point that they were no longer on the pages, but in his heart and in his mind. And there were blotches of ink that had spread as if he left it out in the rain. But when they analyzed the substance, there was salt. Those were not raindrops. Those were teardrops of a broken heart. Read the Word of God. Spend time each day. Even, and this is not so that you'll come, but at least this week you need to afford yourself to get up in the morning and in a quiet place, spend some time with the Word of God. And then just pray. Lord, make this day something special for me. Pray constantly in the Spirit. The Spirit intercedes for us with groans that words cannot express. And so even if your prayers are those prayers that aren't getting anywhere, are you with me? Even if you say, but I keep on repeating the same thing, well, guess what? Don't stop praying. Because even if you're repeating the same words, do you know what the Holy Spirit does? It comes before the Father and groans. What you and I do not do, He does for us. He groans with words that are indescribable before the Father for you and I, and asks the Father those things that we need the most. So pray. Just pray. You know, this lady that I was talking about, we started getting her off of cigarettes that week. So let's start with the cigarettes. She says, but I can't. I can't quit smoking. I'm afraid. I don't know what to do. I'll probably start smoking the next hour. And I said, so you have a problem every hour? So you know what we did? And I told you this story before, but this is a new story. This only happened 2 weeks ago in St. Louis, Missouri. Every hour we went to visit her in her house. Our team went. But then at night we couldn't go visit and we didn't have enough people. So I left her my phone number. Not a good idea, but because I found out later that insomnia, that she has insomnia. So she wakes up at 2 in the morning, hello, Ed? And I'm waking up in a stupor at 2 o'clock in the morning and sitting there in the hotel room, and then I would say, Frederica, open your Bible on the phone and read a psalm to me. And she would read a psalm. And she says, but I'm losing it. I can't, there's so many negative thoughts. And I'm scared to be alone. Frederica, read the Bible. And she would read the Bible a chapter. I said, Frederica, pray on the phone with me. And she would pray. And then I would say, how are you feeling? I think I want to go to sleep. I think I'm at peace. I want to go to sleep. What a wonderful thing. What a wonderful thing. By the way, she's off of cigarettes. She's ministering to other people this week. Of course, what she didn't know is when she wakes up, I never go back to sleep. The praying the Spirit in all occasions. And be a source of hope for others. Our dependence upon God grows as we minister to others. And all these things we're going to talk about this week, and we're going to develop and study from the Word of God. What does it mean? What does it mean to have the joy of salvation? What does it mean to experience a new life? What does it mean to serve others? And how can we go about it? For we are God's work, handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. You see, Jesus invites us to take the yoke. In Matthew chapter 11 and verse 28, come to me all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am gentle and humble at heart, and you will find rest for your souls. Are you burdened today? Are you weary? Are you tired of going through the motions? You know what Jesus says? Come to me. But Lord, my life is not worth anything. Don't say that. You are sons and daughters of God, elected before the creation of the world. The privilege that we have and the hope that we have of being sons and daughters of God, we cannot even imagine, the Apostle Paul says. And the reason for that is that we will have a position in heaven that no one else will have. How about that, folks? Because the Bible says that we will be kings and priests together with Jesus Christ. Think about that. There are no angelic hosts or created beings in the universe who can call themselves sons and daughters of God throughout eternity except you and I. How about that? And Jesus reassures us of that and says, don't think that you're nothing. Because I thought that you were something so special that I came and died for you. That I was willing to give all. And I'm willing to give all today. So come to me. Come to me. Oh, but Lord, there are certain strongholds in my life. You know what I'm talking about, right? The things that we've tried to conquer but have not been able to. Do you know what Jesus says? That he will give you new life. And in that new life, you don't no longer need to be a slave to sin. But you can be freed. You can be freed. If you want to stop going through the motions, Jesus says, come to me. Take my yoke. But what does this mean about taking Jesus' yoke? This is an analogy taken from the farm life. Well, let me explain what the yoke is in biblical terms. You see, yokes are used to train farm animals, like oxen. A baby oxen can almost weigh 700 pounds. How about that? And so a baby oxen is a very stubborn animal, because that's where the saying says, stubborn as what? A mule, but actually an oxen. Because if you bridle an oxen, in other words, put the bridle on them, and you pull to the right, guess what the oxen does? As soon as it feels something in its mouth, it'll actually pull away the other direction. If you say giddy up, you know what it'll do? It'll actually sit down. It's very stubborn. And you can't pick up a baby oxen. But how do they become useful farm animals? They actually yoke them to another oxen, to a mature, trained oxen. And so that baby oxen yoked, you see that? A place for two? Yoked together with the other oxen. When it feels the reins pulling to the right, it will turn. Where? It'll actually resist. But guess what happens? The big oxen knows it needs to turn to the right. So guess what? Because a baby oxen has nothing to do when the big oxen get their way. It's interesting that when you yoke animals together in a farm, after you take the yoke off, after you take that instrument off of them, the big oxen will get up in the morning to drink, and guess what the little oxen does? It gets up to drink whether it's thirsty or not, because it still thinks it's yoked to the other animal. If the other one goes out to pasture, it goes out to pasture together. You know what Jesus says? If you would come and walk with me, you will receive life.
Amen.
You will receive life. Come to me and be yoked to me, and I will teach you. I will lift your burdens off. The last verse in the Bible that I want to read this morning is an invitation to have a growing experience in God. Now we can experience life and peace in the presence of God, but grow in the grace and the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ and Savior. To him be the glory now and forevermore. Amen. That's the finishing of the Apostle Peter's letter. But grow. But grow. Folks, I don't know about you, but I'm kind of tired of going through the motions. Kind of tired of being called a Christian and yet living a life that denies the very essence of Christianity. It's time. It is time. And you would say, as I would say if I were sitting in your place, it's time because you came, because we're going to have these meetings, and that's because it's time. No, folks, it's not because of that. It's time that you owe it to yourself to start living a life worth living. It can only come if you accept Jesus' invitation. Come. Come. Let's walk together. I'd like you to be thinking, because I'm going to make a call right after this. There's a song that I've asked, requested. It's actually the song Through the Motions. Do we have it? By West. Thank you so much. Thank you. Are you ready to go all the way? I'd like to invite you. I'd like to invite you today to take the first step. See, every night there will be singing, which I believe is the most important. There will be some boring preaching. But one thing that will happen every night is that we're going to challenge you to take a step every night. And it'll be a tangible, doable step to going all the way. I can guarantee, if you can just put that the last slide up, not that I can guarantee, but tonight's subject is the guarantee of the new life. And guess what? It's already been guaranteed. And all you need to do is avail yourself of it. Are you willing to say with me today, Lord, it's time to go all the way. I want to go all the way with you. I want to make such a difference in my life that now I can experience eternity today. Is that your will? Would you stand with me? Just one last appeal. I'm going to ask the ushers to please be ready with the little slips that were provided. There might be some here today, and I'm going to make that appeal every evening. Someone here today who has been considering doing one of the most important steps in life. You know, there are only four occasions in life that are very important. Two you have nothing to do with. That's when you're born and when you die. But there are two other occasions that are very important. The other one's when you get married. That's a big decision. But the other one, and most important of all the others, because that one actually will affect everything else, is when you give your life to God to be reborn again. And so there might be some people this morning even that have been thinking about surrendering their lives in baptism, and have been considering it, and you'd like to know a little bit more about it. If you would raise your hand, I would like the deacons just to give you a sheet of paper that I want you to fill out, because I want to come and see you personally with Sonia, and I want to talk about this decision with you and what it means. So if you've been thinking about that, please raise your hand and keep it up so the deacons can just pass that little piece of paper to you. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, you are such a gracious God, that you would take mere dust, fashion it into a human that would rebel against you, that would bring such strife and pain to the universe. And yet even those rebellious children of yours, that you would take the initiative, that you would come to this earth and die for us. And today to live, to intercede, to give us your Holy Spirit, O Lord, to even change our prayers when we don't know what to pray for. But most of all, that even today, now, we can experience a life that is beyond imagination. Lord, forgive us, because we've created so many barriers. So many barriers. And we live with them daily to the point that we have denied the Christian faith. And so that we are no different. We are no different than others who do not know you. Lord, today, we want that to change. We want to go all the way. And we are reassured. That's why, Lord, I have all the confidence in the world. We are reassured that if only we open our lives to you, if we remove those obstacles, that you would produce the growth, that you would bring the new life, that we could go about life in such a way that even now we can say, Lord, we live eternity now, even today, in your presence. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Please remain standing as we sing our closing hymn. All to Jesus I surrender, all to him I freely give. Number 309, and it'll also be on our screen. All together.
Heavenly Father, it has been good to be here with you. But we don't want to go alone. So please come with us to our homes. Please come with us in our lives. For we only can ask because of Jesus and in his name. Amen.
Amen.